From the balmy rolling hills of South Central Florida, this is Far Out Radio. I'm Scott Teeters, and today is Wednesday. It's July the 2nd, 2014. Hope you had a good day, and happy belated birthday, Bro Bob. I know you're listening. Conspiracy scientist Robert Morningstar is back with us this evening. Last weekend, Robert was a speaker, presenter at the Secret Space Program and Breakaway Civilization Conference in San Mateo, California. Karen and I watched the entire conference via the live stream, and it was gratifying to see so many brilliant, thoughtful people that were willing to look beyond the question, when will the government tell us what's really going on up there? Well, the Jersey guy in me says, forget about it. It's not going to happen, folks. It was a far-out and heady experience being able to attend the conference from the comfort of our home. Access to the live streaming was just $60 for the 2 days. The program ran from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. Pacific time, and when you subtract out the lunch and dinner breaks plus the time in between the speakers, there were about 9 hours of presentations each day, and that works out to about a whopping $3.30 per hour to listen to such a brilliant cast of presenters. And as an added bonus, event organizers Heinrich Pellgram of Red Ice Radio and his friends made the entire event available for 30 days to those who bought a streaming ticket. So where are you going to get a better deal than that, huh? The other presenters included former Assistant Secretary of Housing and Federal Housing, Catherine Austin Fitz. Catherine talked about the off-the-books financial aspect of the secret space program that technically makes it a criminal enterprise. Technical illustrator and aeronautics illustrator Mark McChanless shared with us his spacecraft insights. Richard Dolan was there to talk about the breakaway civilization. That's a very fascinating, interesting aspect of the conversation. John Rappaport talked about mass brainwashing in our modern culture and how it's not good to think on your own, baby. I think John secretly wants to be a stand-up comic, but he was great. Dr. Carol Rosen told us about her years working in the aerospace industry and her time as a personal assistant to NASA lead rocket scientist Wannar von Braun. Dr. Joseph P. Farrell talked on a wide range of topics, including the Philosopher's Stone, the secrets of the unified field, and how it relates to new physics of advanced spacecraft. And Bob Bigelow was on hand to talk about the privatization of space and the Disclosure Project. And Michael Surratt talked about mystery aircraft and classified propulsion systems buried deep within the military-industrial complex. For me, it was an experience that added many new aspects to my understanding of the subject that I've been fascinated with for over 50 years. Now, since Robert Morningstar was a presenter, and he presented and he participated in the Saturday night roundtable discussion and the Q&A session, he has a unique perspective on the conference. And because Robert is a friend of Far Out Radio and a friend of yours, I thought it would be worth the time to have Robert back for a debriefing, as well as his thoughts on what's next. Robert, are you there? Welcome back to the program.
Yes, I am here, and it's great to be back. It's been quite an adventure, I have to tell you.
Yeah, good to be back in the Big Apple, huh?
Well, yep, and ready for the hurricane.
Yes, that's right.
We may have some really good special effects tonight. There's a thunderstorm moving through, and I have the window wide open. It's pouring tropical rain, harbinger of a hurricane that's coming up the coast. It just gives you an idea of how vast this weather system is, that it's just leaving Florida and moving through South and North Carolina tonight, and I'm already feeling the effects up here. The air is hot, humid, tropical, kind of sweet, and the thunder is, we'll see. You hear it?
Well, I didn't hear that one.
In New Jersey right now.
It is actually warmer up there where you are than it is here in South Central Florida. It only went up to about 86 today, and I was talking with a friend that a former coworker that is in Medford, New Jersey, where I used to live, and he told me it was 96. So, wild weather, that's for sure.
Well, I'm actually a U.S. government certified weather specialist. I've been so for about 12 years. But my specialty is space weather, and I watch that both as terrestrial space weather by watching the GOES satellite. There are two satellites that monitor the East Coast and the West Coast. And people can get that through NOAA if you want to become familiar with space weather. But there's another kind of space weather which involves solar system activity and coronal mass ejections, and X-ray flares from the sun, and how whether we're going to pass through the stuff.
Yeah, and how it which affects, you don't want to do.
But anyway, all of this, the point of this space weather stuff is that this secret space program is intimately tied with monitoring all kinds of space weather. And I would say UFOs are a kind of weather, too. The program was fantastic. The organizers, and I would like to give them due credit, did a marvelous job, the most professional group of people that I've ever worked with. Secret Space Program, Jeroen van Straten and Henrik Palmgren, whom you've mentioned, and then Robert Dupper and Robert Gisling and the support group, and, well, you all know it's a long list of names, but Maddie and Sandra and Elaine, everyone did a wonderful job, and I'm very gratified to have been there. I'm honored to have been on the same platform with Joseph Farrell, Catherine Austin Fitz, Mark Canvas, Michael Schratt, and everyone who was there, including the guests who showed up, Stephen Bassett. I understand Bob Bigelow was there, although we didn't get to meet. And many luminaries from the West Coast UFO community. John Rappaport was a real experience to sit there and listen to him. And you made allusion to humor and comedy. And I feel that it was a masterful presentation, because one of the things that a masterful presenter can do is present very, very hard and difficult to fathom ideas that might frighten some people, and to put a patina of humor around it to lessen the distress that would come if someone were so dead serious. You know?
Yes.
So humor is a form of defense of the mind. And as I say to people, you know, in crisis, catastrophe, I've found that human reactions to dealing with it come in basically two forms, fear or laughter. You know, you either freeze in paralysis, fear, shock, stricken, or my personal reaction is I'll give a laugh, a wild laugh at it, and that laughter rumbles through your body and moves all your muscles, whereas fear constricts every muscle and paralyzes you. So when you see a danger, and move on it instinctively, laugh it off, but move. Don't sit there, stand there, stricken with fear and paralysis. So I think that John Rappaport's presentation was one of the highlights of the weekend. And what he spoke about, mass mind control, and the government's attempt to stuff your mind back into your body. He has a wonderful way with words, and
yes,
I was very, you know, he's a poet. John is also a poet, and as are many of the people who spoke. And it was really great to hear him expose mass mind control, because that is the essence of the cover-up of the secret space program. How were the powers that be able to strip $40 trillion from the U.S. economy, pour it into black programs and operations, and further operations that covered it up? It's a huge loss to the nation, and the reason that we are in a certain amount of economic distress. So Catherine Austin Fitz tore apart the federal budget and showed everyone how a huge drain was imposed on the economy. And as I said, $40 trillion went offshore or poured into black operations programs, secret space programs, mind control programs. She didn't mention that, but right, it's all part and parcel of the same package. And as a result, everyone walked away with a clear understanding of how this global secrecy And it is global. It's not just secrecy within the United States government or in the Department of Defense. It's a secrecy that involves the entire banking industry worldwide. Then, of course, Joseph Farrell and Michael Schrott and Mark McCandless really did a fantastic job with the hardware and the physics of the secret space program. Joseph Farrell and I see eye to eye on a lot of things, and we have the same background knowledge. For example, on the role of a Galen organization in establishing our intelligence and espionage networks. Galen was the head of Hitler's intelligence service, and he, like Wernher von Braun, surrendered to the United States in the hope of saving himself, his head, from being lopped off his shoulders by the Russians, who forgave no Nazis. You know, the Nazis were so vile in Russia that there was no mercy on the part of the Russians to the people who had pulled it off. So that included
Stalin's Russia didn't give. They didn't believe in mercy. Joseph Stalin was infamous for the statement that in war there are no prisoners of war, only traitors. So when we handed back all the Russian prisoners of war, Stalin made sure they were all murdered.
Indeed,
nice ally.
Both he and von Braun hoped to escape that fate, and they were wise enough to save their documents and make an agreement. But the agreement, actually, I know quite a lot about it, was totally illegal and unconstitutional, and it was made without the president. It was presented to President Truman as a fait accompli after a certain general, Robert Siebert, General Siebert, had received the offer from Galen in a prisoner of war camp and made the agreement to take the entire Nazi espionage network that was still operating behind what would become the Iron Curtain. There was no Iron Curtain yet, but it was coming. A year later, Winston Churchill dubbed it the Iron Curtain. So this agreement was made, and that's how the paperclip Nazis began to infiltrate the United States. There, I say it so bluntly. Yeah. Trojan horse.
Robert, it has to be stated bluntly. This secret apparatus that we're all chafing and suffering under right now, is the SS, folks.
It's exactly so. Listen, I put it very bluntly, I think, last week. I said, we enlisted the Nazis to teach us how they did it. The Nazis taught us how they did it. The Nazis are dead, but now we still do it like the Nazis taught us to do it. Could anything be more clear than that?
Not as far as I'm concerned.
Well,
unless you wrap it up in a red, white, and blue flag.
We have to retrench and build a protective ditch and bulwarks around the Constitution, because that is the target.
Yeah.
And it's becoming self-evident. I'd like to say a little bit more about the other presentations and presenters. Let's see. Of course, Richard Dolan is actually the person who coined the word breakaway civilization about 5 years ago. And it's taken root. And this is a marvelous insight that Richard had. And he spoke about one of his many of his insights. He's got about four or five books, going from UFOs in the national security state to UFOs for the 21st century mind. And he dealt with the sociological aspects and the effects on science and society, and why it's important for all of us to wake each other up as to what is really happening. And I recommend his book, especially if those of you who don't know his work, you can start with the very first one, UFOs in the National Security State. Carol Rosen used to work with NASA, worked personally with Wernher von Braun, and she gave us a really spirited presentation of the need for all of us to work for the peaceful uses of outer space.
Mm-hmm. She seems like a sweet lady.
She's a sweet lady. She's an accomplished scientist. She has a long, an excellent record of bringing Wernher von Braun's message to the world, which was that the powers that be are going to use fear to ingrain a sense of insecurity in the populace, and that they would be conducting war on terrors, war against aliens, wars against asteroids. And this thing about perpetual warfare, it's a theme that I touch on regularly, because with the War Powers Act of 1941, tremendous amount of unconstitutional power was delegated in the crisis to Franklin Delano Roosevelt. After the war, when the war was over, the War Powers obviously the war powers were no longer necessary, since we were not in an overt war. So they should have been recalled. But in order to perpetuate the arrogation of these powers to the executive office, a plan was made to live in a state of perpetual warfare. And so this state of perpetual warfare involved the Cold War, the Korean War, the Cold War, the Vietnam War, the war on poverty, the war on drugs, the war on every single social issue that they tout in every campaign. The war on blah, blah, blah is the excuse for maintaining the power, the War Powers Act, and all of the unconstitutional prerequisites that the presidency has arrogated through this concept of a War Powers Act. So after the Vietnam War ended, there was no war that we were involved in, and so Nixon had to come up with another war to justify the perpetuation of the War Powers Act, and that was the war on drugs, mm-hmm. the war on crime.
Let's not forget the war on poverty and the war on cancer, too. We never seem to be able to win any of these things.
So this mentality of maintaining the country in a state of perpetual warfare
good for business.
Validates their claim to hold on to these powers that they've had since Pearl Harbor, a little after Pearl Harbor. But it really is unjustified. And the message of from Dr. Rosen was that Wernher von Braun foresaw this. He knew the master plan, you might say, of the New World Order, and he forewarned her to forewarn us to not to fall for the propaganda and the mass mind control that that John Rappaport was exposing, and the message that Joseph Farrell brought to us of this the Nazi International. Nazis survived the war and hoarded billions and billions of dollars then, which would be trillions and trillions of dollars now. And they implemented something that Dr. Farrell labels the Nazi International. And those of us who know the secret dealings of the Nazi intelligence services after the war know it as Der Spinner, the spider. The spider web, the spinner, and other names. Odessa, that's another one. Odessa involves Nazis that overlap between the Germans and sympathetic Ukrainian and white Russians who were Nazis. So, as I said, we hired the Nazis to teach us how to do it like they do. We learned how the Nazis did it. The Nazis died, and now we do it like the Nazis did it. And people better wake up that that is what is being implemented, instrumented, and mass mind control is part of it, keeping you in the dark. So I would say we have a lot more to talk about, because really we are just scratching at the surface. But there is also, you know, I don't want to paint it all in dire terms, but the fact that we had this conference, the fact that we had 900 people over 2 days and many thousands many thousands of people on the live stream shows that the message got out. Mm-hmm. And this is a foundation. And I want to make an analogy between this event and another event that happened in 1946 in the city of San Francisco. And that was the foundation of the United Nations occurred in San Francisco in 1946. And this convention was attended by John F. Kennedy and many other luminaries to sign the United Nations Charter. Now, John Rappaport spoke about mass mind control, mentioned MKUltra, Manchurian candidates, and I want everyone to know that we all know that the person that ran the MKUltra program was Cord Meyer of the CIA. Now, let me go back to 1946 in San Francisco at the UN Charter signing. The UN Charter was primarily written by Cord Meyer. John F. Kennedy attended that signing and that of the charter as a reporter. Also present was Mary Meyer before she married Cord Meyer, Mary Pinchot. And so there is quite a history here. And I want to say that I think that what happened in San Francisco this weekend by the torrent of truth that was given to the American people by this outstanding patriots and geniuses, actually, who have devoted their lives to getting to the truth. This torrent of truth is a seminal event in the awakening of the American people, and I will liken it today to that day in 1946.
Robert, we have to take our break. We have our music playing. Before we zip off, I also want to point out that Wernher von Braun told Carol Rosen back in the 70s that they will eventually, when the Cold War is over, they'll roll out the worldwide war on terrorism. And then after that, and he was absolutely serious, he said, watch out, they will stage a fake ET invasion. So keep looking up, folks, and we'll be right back. And welcome back to Far Out Radio. If you're just joining us, Robert Morningstar is back for another visit, and you can keep up with Robert's work. He's the co-editor, and here's where you can keep up with his work at ufodigest.com. He's also very active on Facebook. And when I was just a little boy, my big brother turned me on to the Twilight Zone, and I've never been the same since. We stuffed a lot of information in the first half hour of the program, Robert. I want to go back to one little factoid that kind of went right on by. We were talking about the money aspect that Catherine Austin Fitz talked about, and you mentioned the number $40 trillion. Well, for our listeners that aren't familiar with those kinds of numbers, I want to point out that $40 trillion is equal to 40,000 billion bills, okay? 40,000 billion. If it's in a paper bill, bill, you would need 40,000 billion dollar bills to get the 40 trillion. And remember, a billion is 1,000 million. We're talking
about. And remember that Harold Issa described the $17 trillion as more money than we would have spent if we spent $1 million every day since Jesus was born.
Right.
That's only $17 trillion. Anyway, really, it is a staggering amount of money that disappeared into the military-industrial pharmaceutical complex. That's the word that Eisenhower wanted to say on that last night in office.
I thought he wanted to say congressional complex. I saw that one time should have copied it.
That last one, which is the mind control apparatus that's involved in this. They are medicating and narcotizing everyone, from children to veterans to old people. And it's all part of something that I call population pruning. The people who are running this government look at numbers and dollar signs and forget that they are people. And in order to pursue profit and cut losses, they are actually writing off certain groups of people, denying them treatment. The Obamacare bill denies people over 76 cancer treatment because the prospect of the rest of their lives, the productivity of the rest of their lives, does not seem worth it to them for the investment necessary to prolong their lives.
Yeah.
And I believe that our veterans have been betrayed.
Indeed.
And that they're being treated like cattle.
And the message for us boomers is take very good care of yourself. Stop polluting yourself with fake food and weird drinks because you need to take care of yourself. Just because you have health care doesn't mean you're going to be healthy. Just because you can go to a doctor doesn't mean you'll be healthy. And just because you can get prescription drugs does not mean you will be healthy.
How about mind control medicine? The imposition of illnesses through psychological suggestion. Telling people that they have something, ingraining fear, anxiety, that then creates other symptoms of stress and then distress. There's a whole book. I mean, it's the invention of syndromes, the invention of diseases, both actual concepts of physical disease and mental illness.
How many new mental illnesses are there in the new DMS? I forget, but I think they doubled.
Over 500.
Yeah, it almost
and
doubled.
And this is part and parcel of the process of trying to control not only the population size, but the content of the population's thinking. Forcing conformed thinking, conformity upon all us all.
If you're shy now... That's a disease. That's a mental illness. Shyness disorder is a mental illness.
Well, anger is being criminalized. And you know something? Anger is not a crime. Anger is a basic human instinct. And actually, it's a warning to people to prevent aggression. Anger is a warning sign given to somebody or between two parties or two groups that, hey, you're treading on sacred ground here. You don't cross the line. You are approaching a kindling point.
Mm-hmm.
So now anger is criminalized, and if you are angry, you are mentally ill. That's total BS.
Yeah.
That
to be
angry is a sign of mental illness.
Have you ever seen the movie Wall-E?
And then
have you ever seen the animated film Wall-E?
No, I haven't seen it.
Oh, it's worth watching. It's a wonderful metaphor for where we're heading. For our listeners who maybe have seen it, the scenes that depict the future where humanity is on an enormous spaceship and everybody is enormous and they're floating around on these lounge chairs with screens in front of their faces where they chitter-chatter all day long and their food and their drinkies are delivered and all they do is chit-chat and watch things and laugh and giggle and it's watch the movie. That's where we're headed. Anyway, I don't want to be too grim about this. But
one of the things that we spoke about is the content of people's thinking, and I advise people to review their own thinking and to say to yourself, is the thought I'm thinking really my own, or is it just a stream of consciousness where you're just rambling and regurgitating, repeating what you have heard on TV or ideas that have been planted by news? And people say, oh, you know, nobody can mind control me. You know, I know what I'm thinking. But anybody who says that, I'll ask you this. Has there ever been a day in your life when you heard a jingle in your head or a slogan and it started to go on and you couldn't get the song out of your head?
Yeah.
Well, folks, that moment you were under mind control. Somehow you broke it. But there are other people.
I still have the ones from the 50s and 60s rattling around in my noggin.
Yeah, I know. You know what? A lot of political sloganing, it becomes that, you know? And it stays embedded, and it will pop up on you for years and years after those campaigns, you know? Like, what comes to mind is I like Ike, you know? And I used to look at the picture of the bald guy and say, I don't know, I don't like him. Because I was already being, you know, ingrained with Democrat in New York. You grow up Democrat, and then you break out. Sorry, folks, I'm an independent. It took me a long time to find out the difference. Do people realize or know that the word Bolshevik in Russian, translation for the word Bolshevik, is Democrat?
There you go.
Nice. Put that in your pocket.
I think I hear music playing in the background, Robert, so we're going to get ready to gracefully take our break as we roll into our last segment with our guest, Robert Morningstar. On the other side of the break, as we roll up the last segment, Robert, you said you made a surprising statement about Albert Einstein that got a big round of applause. So I'd like you to talk a little bit about that on the other side.
Okay.
And then also, were there any big surprises for you? And also, where do you think we're headed with all this? So we'll take our commercial break, and we'll be right back with our guest, Robert Morningstar. And welcome back to Far Out Radio. We're pulling into our last segment this evening with our friend Robert Morningstar talking about the Secret Space Program Conference last weekend in California, where Robert was one of the presenters. Robert, on Saturday night during the roundtable or the Q&A, you made a rather bold statement about Albert Einstein. I think you basically said that it's time we move beyond Einstein. And what surprised me the most was you got a pretty good round of applause for that.
Yes, I wasn't surprised. I think that there are a lot of people, clear-thinking people, in this field in particular, the field of ufology, zero-point energy, Tesla technology, electromagnetogravitics, who know that the people have been dumbed down and that science has put Albert Einstein on this messiah of science pedestal. And that a lot of what he said was bunk. And the UFOs prove it. Faster than light speed is possible. And if we can't get beyond Einstein in the sense that he put a speed limit, he's like the traffic cop of the 4D world, you see?
Mm-hmm.
I've never said that before, you know? But I'm happy that you asked
it. We'll buy that.
Said it. Albert Einstein is the traffic cop of the four-dimensional world. That's the three dimensions of material, space-time, and the timeline. And unless we can get beyond that speed limit in our thinking, which is imposed by Einstein's relativity theory, we can't get our brains to start cogitating greater concepts than Einstein. And that would be things that involve zero-point energy, faster than light speed, time travel, interdimensional travel. Listen, Einstein fought against the Big Bang Theory with all his might. A Catholic physicist, a Catholic priest who was a very fine physicist named Lemaître, got the idea. You know, everybody was looking at the universe expanding and expanding, and these measurements were coming in from the 20s, and Hubble was making his observations, and a certain group of physicists coalesced on this idea of the expanding universe. And Einstein wanted to believe in this more or less steady-state universe, and he resisted this. Now, Lemaître said in the 1930s, I think it was 34, that the universe had evolved from a single point, that it had all been together in one single point at one time, and the vocabulary he used was the primordial atom. He said that everything was contained in the primordial atom, and then the primordial atom exploded, and all these subatomic realm came from the primordial atom. And Einstein fought him, and he was already the established luminary of science, and he wanted to keep his position. He said to him very arrogantly, "Your theory is interesting, but your mathematics is terrible." Well, that was 34, and Einstein continued to fight the Big Bang Theory until it was undeniable. As a matter of fact, the word Big Bang was first uttered as a sarcasm and a derogatory term by one of the top physicists of the time who was still opposing it. He said something derogatory about the theory and referred to it offhand as the universe didn't start off with a Big Bang. But That's how, it's funny how sarcasm can turn against the person. The term caught on, and now we all accept that the universe came out of a single point from which all future matter was contained, and that single point it came from the Big Bang. And we call it a singularity instead of the primordial atom. So Lemaître was right. So Einstein fought quantum. He fought against quantum mechanics until quantum mechanics showed that some of his equations were a little bit unstable, and he had to include something called the gravitational constant. But I'll say this about Einstein. He let the cat out of the bag a couple of times. And one of the times that he let the cat out of the bag was when he spoke about something that he called Gespensterfeld, the ghost field. He believed for a time in the 20s and 30s, then he recanted it, but he believed that there was an imminent ghost field of energy permeating the universe, and the ghost waves were capable of possibly propagating instantaneously. And then he retrenched, but I always stayed with that that idea, and I pursued it. The question I asked in San Francisco, and I've asked it of many physicists, one physicist said to me, you know, you're right. Another physicist, they were aghast. They just can't utter a word when I ask them this question. Einstein said that we cannot travel faster than the speed of light. Speed of light is symbolized in his equation by C. And yet his equation says that energy equals mass times the speed of light squared. How can Einstein posit C squared in his equation and say it's not possible for us to move faster than C? What is C squared then? So beyond that, there are permutations of his equation that actually prove that the universe did come from a single point, and ultimately that the universe emerged out of nothing. Zip. Nothing. And in the coming year, I'll be expounding more on these discoveries, because that's what they are. I discovered these things in 1977, and I was shocked by what I found. And I said, look what they did with E equal MC squared. Man, what kind of weapons would they build with this? Gravity bombs? Yes, it's possible to create gravity bombs. Let me ask you, what did Einstein leave you? What have we gotten from Einstein? We have this perpetual threat of nuclear holocaust as a result of the atom and the hydrogen bomb. We have atomic medicine, which is not always so good for the host. Mm-hmm. And we have a few other things, but I really can't think about too many things that the world has benefited from Einstein. The other thing that I spoke about, honestly, is this concept that arose from Einstein's theory of relativity, which was hijacked. Now, the theory of relativity is applicable in this 4D world to the observable universe and the interaction between particles, molecules, atoms, quarks, physical stuff. But somebody hijacked that concept of relativity and took it into the moral realm and now speak about moral relativity, the relativity of good and evil. Mankind has a conscience, a God-given conscience, and that conscience is what shows man really what is good and evil. But this concept of the relativity of good, that the lesser of two evils is less evil than the greater evil, that's a fallacy. Evil is evil.
Moral relativity. It sounds like a
moral relativity,
pass.
Which I call the gray morality.
Yeah, it's a pass.
And I leave a hint there as to what we're dealing with.
Robert, in our last couple of minutes, you want to tell us about any surprises that you came away with?
Surprises. Well, there are several surprises at how advanced independent researchers are in their understanding of anti-gravity, and there were people there who are quite capable today of building flying saucers based on Townsend Brown and Wilbur Smith's concepts. The one thing that struck me as a physical thing, there was a videotape taken in Paris of a giant triangle. And for the first time, I saw how those white lights operate in that FDD mode when they go from zip to light. This is unique. A huge triangle UFO with white lights on each corner and a white light in the center overflew someone in a city. I believe it was Paris. Pretty sure it was Paris. I thought it was the Eiffel Tower in the background. But the unique thing about this is that it was very, very cloudy and overcast, and the city lights of Paris were lighting up the sky, so there was a gray sky, and this person had a really good camera. And so this triangle UFO flies over him, going away, with the nose pointing away, like the opening scene in Star Wars, quite frankly, when the first Star Destroyer you ever saw flew over your head chasing the smaller craft. So then it stops, and then it rotated, turned around toward the cameraman. Then it tilted down and pitched up, and then it rotated again on that same bank, and then it showed the bottom lights again at an angle. Then the central light started to glow brighter and brighter and then turned into a hemisphere on the bottom. And then it grew greater and greater, and then you saw that the hemisphere was actually a sphere on top and bottom. And then the white light kept growing and growing until it enveloped all three corners of the triangle UFO, and then it was gone.
Wow.
Impressive.
We're just about out of time, buddy. One of the things I don't remember which of the presenters told this anecdotal story that came from him, from a jogger who was out jogging in the woods, came into a clearing, and he sees up ahead of him a conventional jet aircraft that was just sort of floating in the air as it was pivoting around a tree. And when it got around to the point where the guy was standing there just looking at this thing, and it got around to the point where the pilot happened to notice that he was being looked at, he got out of there in a hurry. But it was interesting that some of these advanced propulsion and anti-gravity systems are being integrated into conventional type aircraft. That was a real surprise thing for me. Is there going to be another similar conference next year, do you know?
Yes, we hope so. We were planning so. We had a meeting afterwards and agreed that it was well received and appreciated, and people asked for another. So we're going to try to find another central location for it, either here in the United States or one in Europe. We'll keep tuned in to UFO Digest and to Far Out Radio and my Facebook page, because...